I say to Gandini, Lucia, if they want you to jump in and add something during my lesson, please do it. I mean, let's make a nice conversation. Allora, digital methods. So let's see. To understand digital methods, we first must understand this concept that is follow the medium. Okay, follow the medium. If we take the literature on pedagogy, we can say that follow the medium, I'm following this kind of literature, follow the medium is a threshold concept, meaning that if
Ale, sorry, Ale, no, we cannot see the slide.
you cannot see the slide. Thank you, Ale. Probably I messed up. Thank you so much. Now?
Yes, I can. I don't know about the others.
Better?
Yes.
Better. Yes.
We
Thank
can.
you. Thank you,
Yes.
guys.
Good.
Sorry, I never get acquainted with this virtual lesson, which I like, by the way, but they are pretty strange. So, follow the medium. Let's repeat. It's called a threshold concept if we follow the language of pedagogy, meaning that if we grasp this concept, we did 50% of our job. Okay? We really can start entering this field, this conceptual field of digital methods. When we talk about digital methods, we talk about a paradigm, okay, a methodological paradigm, very specific, which is well established in sociology, social sciences, and is used as a base, no, for data collection, data analysis, interpretation of data. When I say data, of course, I mean digital data. Okay, so let's get rid of some ambiguity. Ah, sorry. Please have a look at this this website. I mean, if you are really interested in digital methods, the first step you must take is to have a look at this website that is Digital Methods Initiative of Amsterdam, because I mean these guys here, especially Richard Rogers, which is the leader, they invented this paradigm. And so if you take your time to have a look to the website, you will discover a beautiful website with a lot of publication, academic publication related to digital methods, project related to digital methods, also tools. We will see some tools provided by Digital Methods Initiative, but not all of them. So if you go into section tools, you will discover many, many free tools that you can use to collect, analyze, and visualize data. Then also, let's get rid of an ambiguity. So digital methods, first thing first, if you want to define them, they are not virtual methods, okay? Or digitized methods. What I mean, digitized methods are those methods, social research methods, classical, typical of social science, that you simply apply to the digital, transfer to the digital domain, like an online survey, an online interview, online focus group, online ethnography, and so on and so forth. So please, Guy, let's say this straight. These methods are not inferior to digital methods, okay? Are simply different. It's another kind of stuff. So you can do it. You must do. You must use this kind of method when you do digital research. But in the very moment that you do an online survey, you are no more in the paradigm of digital methods. My suggestion is always to, I mean, if it's possible, to try to mix, okay? Sometimes it's not always possible and easy, but it's nice to do a start with a digital methods analysis and then mix something more traditional. For example, in online interview, for example, face-to-face interview that you can do online or offline. Okay, now pay attention. Let's define this concept of digital methods. There are, I mean, many ways of for defining them. I have chosen a very simple one, and especially I chose a lot of examples, okay, to let you understand what is digital methods and what is follow the menu. So I repeat, first and first, the first concept that we must absolutely to understand and grasp is this idea of follow the menu, following the menu. What is the meaning of that? The meaning is, we can translate it, let's say, as learn from the internet, or maybe learn from digital environment, the same digital environment we want to investigate in our digital research. Okay, so follow the medium, I repeat, means methodologically try to learn from the internet, from the digital. So this, let's say, epistemological motto has many implications. The first one is a theoretical one. So from my theoretical point of view, follow the medium means, please, you, researcher, try not to consider the internet so much as an object of study. Okay, could be, but this is not of interest of digital methods. Try not to think internet in this way, as an object of study, but rather as a source of methods. Okay? And practically, we have several other implications of this idea, using internet as a source of methods. First, this means basically, first and foremost, I would say, take advantage, so exploit or take advantage as you prefer, of the natively digital methods that the internet already applied to itself for structuring its flow of information and communication, such as with algorithm, apps, links, tag, retweet, hashtag, and so on and so forth. So I repeat, follow the medium means take advantage of these natively digital methods. And taking advantage of this kind of native digital methods means that you can use, for example, retweets, hashtag as a methodological tools, resources, but also there is also another more subtle way more specific also way to see this. Follow the medium can also means observe, okay, how digital environment treat all these devices like link, tags, and so on and so forth, and take inspiration from your methodological strategies. The second point of follow the medium is, of course, take advantage and use, get acquainted with IT techniques, okay? Because I mean, this is pretty straightforward, right, guys? When we approach the internet, when we want to study stuff on the internet, of course, we have to rely on IT techniques for collecting, storing data, and so on and so forth. And third thing, the most important thing, we all always need to try to repurpose IT techniques, and natively digital methods for social research scope. Okay, so why that? Because if you think attentively, I mean, IT techniques or all these native digital methods like algorithm links, they are not meant for social research, okay? They are meant for the purposes and the logic of the platform of the internet, or the logic of IT scientists, okay? So we must make an effort to repurpose all these technological array for answering our research question. Now, I suppose that maybe you're still confused, okay, about what is digital methods. But don't worry, let's go through some nice example. The first example I want to make you is this one that is proposed by Richard Rogers, in which in his famous article that I put in the recommended readings, that is called "For the End of the Virtual." So it's the founding article of digital methods. And to explain this idea of taking advantage of natively digital methods, he makes the example of Google that he calls epistemological machine. Now, a disclaimer, and of course, this article is of 2009. So when he talks about Google, he has in mind the original functioning of Google, which still exist and resist, but now, as you might know, the functioning of Google is much more complicated. The result that you get are more personalized, geolocalized, but let's forget this for a minute, okay? Just to make an example for our teaching purposes, let's try to consider the basic functioning of Google, that is the functioning with which, I mean, in 2006, Larry and Page developed and delivered Google. So first thing first, Roger says an interesting thing. He calls Google as an epistemological machine, meaning that Google can be considered as a human actor playing a key role in the production, circulation, organization of knowledge within our contemporary society. And how he does that? On the basis of some arbitrary, some parameters that we don't really know, we can grasp, but we don't really know, like popularity or relevance. And so through these parameters, arbitrary parameters, Google decides what kind of information, news, or topic must be visible or not visible. Now, I make your question. Guys, let's try to do something a little bit interactive, okay? If you like, if you don't want, I stop bothering you, but let's try to do a little bit of interaction. So, do you have an idea how Google works? I mean, if I go Google, I put this query sociology, okay? I get a list of results, okay? But which is the logic with which these results appear in the SERP, so the homepage of Google? Do you have an idea?
But you mean right now or before? Because as far before, as I remember— Before, Richard,
thank you.
Okay.
In general, okay? In 2006, and also at the time when Rogers wrote this article, he meant the original functioning. But if you also read something on Google now, you still know that mechanism is still functioning, of course. Around this mechanism, we have a lot of other things. So, but you were correct, Alicia. Thank you. So, the original function.
I think that it was like if you pay, you are at the top. But then they also changed it, and they put like kind of announcement to say that they are at the top score level just because they are paying, something like that. But I don't know if it was this correct.
Correct, Alicia, it's correct. Thank you so much. But I mean, the payment stuff is something different, okay? And also something that arrived later on Google. And again, it is a different logic with which, I mean, we see a website on top on the SERP. Okay, still valid, but I mean, this is not the case. But we are almost there. Thank you, Alicia. So other ideas?
On the top, we can find the site that was consulted more time.
Yes, we are basically there. Consulted more time, you said. Okay, so Paola, basically, get the main idea. Other ideas?
I will say.
Go, Camila.
I will say reputation, like.
Camilla, okay, so reputation is very, very specific and correct. I mean, of course, all of you said correct things, and so just let's put things together. So yes, basically it's sort of reputations. I mean, as you know, I mean, this is not an alphabetical order, okay? If you were familiar with the search engine in the 90s, as I was, I mean, like Yahoo, you had list of websites in alphabetical order that you had to scroll side by side. This is not the case, okay? We have at the top of the SERP a website that Google deems relevant, okay? In this case, you see, for example, Wikipedia. Then we have a Department of Sociology of Oxford University. So of course, these websites are relevant. But how and why are relevant according to Google? they are relevant according to Google because they receive a lot of links, okay? So these are websites that are linked by other, many other websites that again, Google deem relevant, okay? So the point is that Google treats links as reputational markers. Camilla or said reputation, use these correct words, okay? Use links as reputational markers to rank websites, okay? To construct, let's say, hierarchies among websites. And so Richard Rogers and his team, they had this idea, okay? They said, okay, we can take inspiration from this logic, okay? We can consider links as natively digital methods, okay? And we can use links to reconstruct mapping hierarchies among different actors on the web. And that's why they invented this tool that is called a crawler. You can use it if you want to access it. And basically you can put a bunch of links on issue crawler and automatically issue crawler reconstruct the relations of links, so the exchanges of links between different websites, and it assesses which is the most prominent, the most relevant, and so on and so forth. So you are able to reconstruct hierarchies between different kinds of sites. And in the same article, Rogers makes this example and explained that to issue crawler and using links as reputational marker or as native digital methods, he discovered a lot of interesting things. So first and foremost, he discovered something that is called politics of association, okay? When you do, when you map connection between social actors made with links, an interesting thing is try to map this politics of association. Basically, what they did, so they saw the association between three kinds of websites. So governmental website like United Nations, FAO, OXE, I mean, you name it. So all that that you see here in blue. Then they took in yellow companies, pharmaceutical companies, and also last but not least, NGO, like Greenpeace. And they discovered, for example, companies and NGO, they always try to connect with governmental website, but this governmental website, they never link back. And the same is with pharmaceutical company. Pharmaceutical company tend to link and to associate themselves to NGO like Greenpeace, but they never link back. Okay, so you can see a political association within a specific social hierarchy between websites. And on top of this, you can also try to make a reflection on the reputation, on different reputational profiling. Because, for example, they discovered that BeOnline is a website with a very high reputation, because BeOnline is a pharmaceutical company. And as we know, usually pharmaceutical companies do not receive links in general in this political association, but not in this case. So probably, if this is an exception, BeOnline receives a lot of links from governmental website, probably, we can say that this website has an high reputation. Is everything clear so far?
Yeah.
Cool.
Yeah.
Thank you. Now, of course, I presented you some complicated stuff, let's say, related also to politics and politics of association related to institutional actors and so on and so forth. But we can use this kind of tools for more simple, funny and mundane stuff, as I did when I was a young PhD. I also used to work for a marketing company. And in 2012, an important client, Louis Vuitton, asked me to map and reconstruct the entire Italian blogosphere of fashion blogs. So you can imagine it was a tough task, but fortunately, I had, I mean, issue crawler, and with issue crawler, I was able to reconstruct the fashion Italian blogosphere. How? Very simply, I started from a list of 10 fashion blogs. I knew that they were important. Then I put in issue crawler. I used a function called snowball. So with the snowball, issue crawler also is able to discover and retrieve new links, okay, between the website that you give it independently, okay, that you give the name of the website, okay, starting from the initial list with snowball, issue crawler is able to discover new connection, okay, and at the end of the process I get this. It's pretty amazing, but it's very interesting. First and foremost, I was able to give to Louis Vuitton an Excel file, so a complete list of all the fashion blog in Italy. And as you can imagine, at the time, this is a very, very valuable information, because at the time, we didn't really have influencers. Okay, so the fashion influencers basically were bloggers, okay? One, I was able to give them this list. Two, I also gave them a list that was hierarchical ordered, okay? So I could order this website starting from the website that received most links, so the website with the highest reputation, okay, and so on and so forth. Then also with this representation, we discovered something interesting. We discovered that the fashion blogosphere in Italy at the time was split in two parts. You see the upper and the lower cluster. The upper cluster, as you can see maybe, is a cluster of professional fashion bloggers, okay? Because they belong all to the same blog network that is called Blogosphere. And as you can see, I mean, you will see better with Alessandro Gandini, this technicality, but as you will see from the thickness of the labels of this website, the thickness is always the same, meaning that they constantly and in equal way link each other. Okay, this is a political association because they are all part of the same private and professional network. So they try to link each other to raise their visibility. Vice versa, in the lower cluster, we can spot a cluster that we can say is a cluster of a more independent website because they are outside of this professional network. And for Louis Vuitton, I mean, the lower cluster was most valuable because, let's say, it was more authentic, more independent. And also, you see, we discover a sort of association with social media. We discovered that all these blogs tended to link to Twitter. So again, we were able to advise Louis Vuitton and say, okay, if you have budget that you want to put in social media, try to forget Facebook for now because most of the fashion experts tend to migrate on Twitter. And also we were able to spot what was not there. So we realized that here there was not Instagram, okay? And at the time, because we were a marketing company, we knew that Instagram was going to become a big thing. And so again, we were able to advise wisely the Louis Vuitton to put budget also on Instagram. And last but not least, I did another thing. I used another tool that is called Google Scraper. You can use it for free on the website of Digital Methods Initiative. Google Scraper basically is a tool that used for making research on specifically on Google, but also you can repurpose it to try to make a queries between specific website and keywords, okay? It's a way to map this the relationship between specific website and keywords beyond Google. And just to be clear, I show you an example, is what I did. So from the list before, I took the 30 most prominent blogs, okay? And over 1 year, I checked how many times these 30 top blogs mentioned Louis Vuitton. And I did the same with the competitors, Louis Vuitton, Gucci, and Hermes. So first thing first, I was able to identify the most friendly website towards Louis Vuitton. And with the client, we discovered something very, very interesting. You see here on the work, the cloud on Louis Vuitton, Stylosophy, okay, and Lussosissimo. Over 1 year, these blogs mentioned a lot of time Louis Vuitton, but I mean, the client Louis Vuitton was very surprised. They said, okay, we absolutely didn't know about this because we paid Modalizer and Very Cool to produce post about us, but not Stylosophy and Lussosissimo. So we didn't know. So probably we waste budget, and next time we will allocate budget better. And also, as you can see, we tried to see the distance between Louis Vuitton and the Blonde Salad. The Blonde Salad was and is, I suppose, the blog of Chiara Ferragni. So again, we knew that Chiara Ferragni was a big thing. She was going to become a very, very big thing. So it was important to see the relation between Louis Vuitton and Chiara Ferragni. And in this case, we discovered that was more friendly towards Hermes. She mentioned much more times Hermes. So again, Louis Vuitton decided to start a more closer relationship with Chiara Ferragni, and they started to invite Chiara Ferragni in their resorts in Turkey, in Greek, and she started making a lot of blog posts about these resorts of Louis Vuitton. So starting from this very, very simple analysis and visualization, also very ugly visualization. I apologize for that, but Beatrice, in the last lesson, we will show you better visualization. We were able to produce some outputs very relevant from a marketing point of view. Make sense?
Yes.
Thank you, Massimiliano. Very last example, okay, to stress this idea and let you grasp this idea of follow the medium, okay? Let's make a focus on social media, especially because, I mean, during the summer school, we will do a lot of exercises on social media. So let's forget for a while, I mean, the blogs, the links, website, Google, and let's focus on social media. And let's take the retweet. And if we think about the retweet, we get a very, very nice and clear example of what is follow the medium, okay? So the retweet is a device with which everyone can create social connection on Twitter, okay? If I retweet Massimiliano Raffa, sorry, Massimiliano, I see your name here. I took you as an example. I hope you don't mind. If I take my friend Massimiliano, I retweet you, okay? A post, maybe you post a tweet in saying, okay, I hate this summer school, I don't like it, and I retweet you. In this very moment, we have a social connection, okay? Even if very loose, but it's a social connection. In the very moment, I retweet you. But if you think about, the retweet is also the very natively digital methods, or if you prefer, a natively metric with which I can measure, okay, this relation. Because for example, using the retweet, I can see the direction of this relation. So who is retweeting whom? I am retweeting Massimiliano. And the intensity, and Massimiliano doesn't retweet me back. So we have this kind of relation, not symmetrical, let's say. And also the intensity of this relation I can measure with the retweet. So how many times I retweet Massimiliano? For example, 100 times, and Massimiliano retweeted me just one time. And again, you can see there is a different hierarchical relation between us. And thanks to the retweet, I can measure this kind of relation. So repeat, the retweet is not only a device through which users create relations, social relations on Twitter, but it's the very natively digital methods we can take advantage of to measure and map these relations between user. Look at this with Massimo Eroldi, who is not here, and Davide Beraldo. This, let's say, very simple visualization, but at the time, I mean, it was not, because we were still in our infancy with digital methods, and also in Italy. So what we did, we followed the hashtag primaria 2012, so primary election in Italy on Twitter. So we collected a lot of tweets with this hashtag, and we tried to map the relations of the actors using this hashtag exactly using the retweet, okay? And so if you see in this big cluster on my right, we were able to identify the user with the highest reputation in this galaxy of people tweeting with this hashtag, because they were users that were retweeted the most. And as you can imagine, they are basically all politicians and or journalists. And many, many times, most of the times, they retweet each other. And this is interesting. I mean, I don't know if you are familiar with Habermas, but contrary from what, for example, mass media said, I mean, this hashtag, primary election 2012, was not a public sphere, because we didn't have a real conversation, open conversation among politicians, citizens, journalists, institutions, NGO, and so on and so forth. It was a very, very, very close cluster and discussion between few actors that were politicians and journalists. So you see how many things you can do and you can grasp simply using retweet as a methodological resource. Okay, and the last thing I want to show you, because it's important for the other part now, when you use a retweet or whatever kind of metadata on Instagram, Twitter, whatever social media, you see that this metadata allows you to map and visualize the structure of communication within a specific environment. And specifically, you can understand how a specific device, like a retweet, is able to structure the communication within a digital environment. And basically, this is one of the primary and the main task of a digital methods scholar. I mean, of course, it's not the main goal, but usually it's the first thing you do when you approach a digital environment and a digital data set, okay? Try to map the structure of communication within a specific environment by, again, repeat, follow. We have plenty of time. Why I said so, I stressed this? Because when we do digital methods, it's very important to follow the medium. So it's very important to understand how digital devices structure information and communication on the internet, but also it's important to follow the users in some way. Pay attention, I mean, this idea of follow the users is derived by the paradigm of digital methods of Amsterdam, but this is, I mean, not a Richard Roger things, okay? This is an idea that we develop in our Italian cluster of digital methods. Of course, I mean, it's very orthodox because it follows specifically the guidelines and epistemology, I can pronounce it, of digital methods. But I mean, starting from the main epistemology of digital methods, we also started devising this idea of following the users. Why we must follow the users? And what does it mean, and which are the different declination of follow the users from a methodological point of view? Also, I stress, but I just finish here. I mean, this idea of following the user is inspired by Bruno Latour, actor network theory, and multi-sided ethnography. Marcus, so, but I mean, if you are interested, I can share with you some articles, but I don't want you to say more here, just to let you know. Let's take again this example of this Twitter metadata, so the hashtag. The hashtag is a very, very important metadata, very, very useful, because we can say that the hashtag is a device through which users self-categorize their own tweets. Okay? Look at this. We have all these tweets marked with the hashtag Super Bowl. Okay? So immediately, I know that all these tweets are about Super Bowl, okay? I don't need to read all the conversation. I mean, just to grasp the main topic. Following this hashtag, Super Bowl, I'm pretty sure, I mean, that I run into tweets in some way related with this idea, with this topic of Super Bowl. Okay, but as you should imagine, things are not always so simple, because I mean, if you explore and you get acquainted with digital environment, you discover that when you follow hashtags, most of the time, you will see that you have different publics or different crowds or community, whatever. For now, let's use these terms as interchangeable, that use the very same hashtag in very different ways, okay? And so in some way, we need to account for that. Okay, so again, we can use digital methods to account for that. But first and foremost, we must have this idea, this theory in mind before entering a digital field. Because I repeat, in many, many cases, and probably you will see in your exercises, the very same hashtag, the very same device, the very same platform is used in a way that is totally different from public to public, community to community. And I make you again this very simple example. Again, pretty old, but it gives you the idea. So in 2013, we followed this hashtag boycott Barilla, because the CEO Guido Barilla, the CEO of Barilla, Guido Barilla, make a very unfortunate and homophobic statement. He said, okay, in a radio program, I guess, if I remember well, pasta Barilla is for normal family, okay? It's meant for normal family, not for gay family, okay? And as you can imagine, in a matter of second, a shitstorm on Twitter started. And we followed the hashtag, and first and foremost, we realize that many people from different parts of the world, use this hashtag. So we had Italian, German people, French, American, and so on and so forth. And so we did a simple thing. We distinguished two kinds of languages, English and Italian, because I mean, it was easiest for us. And we isolated tweets written in English and tweets written in Italian. And we discovered this very interesting thing. So basically they use the same hashtag, but the Anglo-Saxon tweets, they use this hashtag boycott Barilla in order to promote at least virtual boycotting towards Barilla, okay? Vice versa, in Italy, most of the tweets and most of the people use this hashtag to criticize this campaign of boycott Barilla that they believe was basically a bullshit campaign. So you see this important difference and the importance to follow the users along with the medium. I mean, if you want to know more, I suggest you this article from Barnes and colleagues called Towards a Topology of Hashtag Publics, in which this concept is explained better, let's say, with much more examples. And they show how on Twitter different hashtags attract very different publics. For example, And these different publics create a different social environment around these hashtags. For example, if you follow an hashtag like FIFA or Charlie Hebdo, they see that around this hashtag, publics create these acute events. Mm? So meaning kind of hashtags that attracts a lot of retweets and a lot of URL. Mm? And users use these hashtags and the tweets related to this hashtag to do a sort of gate watching. Mm? So sharing information, commenting these events in real time, and so on and so forth. Vice versa, if you follow hashtag like MasterChef, you see something totally different. So different publics creating different social environment around the hashtag. And in the case of MasterChef, for example, you have this media event. So an hashtag that attracts very low percentage of retweets and very low percentage of URL, in which people use Twitter as a second screen. So I hope now that you get the idea of following the users along the medium. Following the users means also that sometimes you can seek the collaboration of users, okay? You can use users as a social researcher, as collaborator. What I mean? I mean that if you're patient, if you follow attentively the traces that users leave behind on social media or whatever, you can discover interesting things that probably you wouldn't discover otherwise. And I give you another marketing example. This is something I did with Guido Anselmi and Massimo Eroldi again for a client called Warsteiner, if you know Birra Warsteiner beer, by the way. It's not so important. So they wanted to know more about the hipster culture. We were in 2014, I guess, so the 8 days of hipster culture. And so what we did, we just go on Instagram, we put this hashtag, we used this hashtag hipster, we followed this hashtag, and we collected a lot of images and posts, like 10,000, something like that. But as you can see, we were not able to run into the classical hipster stereotype, okay? Look at the image on my right. I took from Google, not from Instagram. So we were not able to run into these stereotypes of Twitter, so into the specific hipster subculture. What we got was basically all photos like this one on my left, in which you have a normal girl, ordinary thick pair of glasses, and she tagged his photo with the hashtag hipster. So we don't have anything about the hipster culture. We have more a play. So let's play this game of hipsterizing things or a label. Let's make let's associate to specific object of situation this idea of hipster or hipsterism. Okay, so repeat. Simply because, I mean, she were wearing these thick glasses, black glasses that are typical of hipsters, she tagged her photo with this hashtag hipsters. So starting from this, we checked all the association of the hashtag, starting from the main hashtag hipster, and we discovered, you see below, this hashtag Tumblr. And so we had this intuition that then we discovered that it was right, that probably people associate this hashtag Tumblr to the hashtag hipster because they deem that this object Tumblr is an hipster thing, is an hipster object. And in fact, we went on Tumblr and images and post a kind with a typical stereotypical imaginary of the hipster, which were the initial request of our client, okay? So also these are declination of follow the user. Another idea of follow the user is something that we developed very, very recently. Me, Lucia, and Alessandro in this article. If you want to read, please be our guest. We are happy. that is called From Archive Cultures to Ephemeral Content. And in this article, we study Instagram stories and we pose ourselves this problem, how to get Instagram stories, okay, methodologically. Because, I don't know if you know, but okay, now the API of Instagram are super closed. Using some tools like Crowdtangle that we have now, we can access the API of Instagram, but you can't in any case get stories, Instagram stories from Instagram using the API. So it is an object very, very difficult to grasp. And so we had this problem and we asked ourselves, okay, how we can collect stories from Instagram in order to study. And basically we solved the problem simply following the users, okay? So we discovered that people normally use this kind of tools. There are plenty, at the time, of this tool like StorySaver, which are scrapers basically, that people use to save and store their stories, because as you know, stories disappear. So in our article, we derive this idea of following the user, meaning follow, take advantage, use whatever, the methods, okay, that internet users use to collect, save, and store their own data, okay? Is it clear this point of for the user? I take as a yes.
Yes.
Any questions? Okay.
There is something in the chat.
Something in the chat. I can't read. Diego Rinaldo, another example is Proud Boys, which was originally used by Trump supporter. Homophobic, macho, blah, blah, blah. Diego, I lost track on this. Can you, if you like?
Oh, it was, this.
Wow, what is that?
This comment was referred to when you were talking of Parilla on the fact that the same action can be used by very different people and to interact with each other in oppositional manner. So this is a more recent example.
Example. Thank you so much, Diego.
The same point that you were making.
So thank you.
Slides ago, not referring to StorySaver and to what you just said.
Yeah. Compliment for the background is beautiful. Please feel free to jump in. I mean, every one of you, feel free to jump in. I mean, I know that we are in a strange class, but we are all colleagues, by the way, okay? So this is not a classical lecture done in the university. So please feel free to jump in and make questions.
Alessandro, I do have a question, actually. I'm sorry.
Go ahead.
I don't know if you, yeah, just to be sure if I'm, because when you say follow the user, I was reflecting on the fact that seems to me that it's more following the object in terms of, like, because you mentioned the actor network theory, right? And in this case, you follow an hashtag and how this hashtag has been used by some people, right?
Yeah.
So I was thinking that, for instance, other thing can be used even to create a sort of community, to create a public discourse around it. I was thinking to give you an example to the no vax movement, right? That sometimes even an article may be written by a celebrity in terms of, you know, like a doctor or a physician who became, sorry for the noise, who became like a reference star because of the no vax movement and how this article can be, or link or whatever, can be followed, right? Let's say if we start to follow where this article was adopted and even a community start to develop around this concept idea that I said article, but could be a link or whatever. I don't know if it makes sense for you, just try to follow in a maybe more science technology perspective, a sort of artifact, which is not a person, is a more non-human, right? Follow this and see the path and the trajectory of this, if we can reconstruct a community of people not sharing the same idea, because the article maybe create the idea of it. And I thought immediately about the no vax movement, but could be anything. Because I don't know if it makes sense for you or is.
It makes totally sense. Can you see me?
Yeah.
By the way, thank you, Veronica. It makes totally sense. Actually, the point of this follow the user thing is basically what you described now. So the starting idea is to first and first following the object. So in our book and in my article, if you are willing to have a look, all of you, that is called Digital Methods for Ethnography, we, Gandini, exactly theorize this. So the first task that we have to do is follow tracing objects and follow this movement of object within an environment or within multiple environments. Then, after following the object, I mean, my suggestion is to follow the medium. So let's see how the communication technically structured around this object, but also try to follow the user. For example, if you read Bernard Rieder, a very, very prominent digital method scholars, he doesn't use this term of follow the user, but basically he proposed the same logic. Have a look to the article, Ranking Culture. So he very convincingly say, okay, the results on YouTube depends on one end, on of course, from the YouTube article. But on the other end, on how he say the participatory cultures, he used this term, how participatory culture manipulate this device. Mm-hmm. And also, thank you, Veronica, because you touched a very, very important thing. When I say follow the user, I mean also non-human user, okay? I can follow bots, okay, using hashtags in a specific way. Did I reply to your question?
Totally, and thank you so much for.
And thank you for jumping in. I mean, you make my lecture easier. I mean, if we talk a little bit. I'm just in the basement because it is the only quiet place in the home. So it's a very dark and daunting setting. And also it's strange to talk to a screen, so it's nice to have a nice conversation sometimes. What time is it? Okay, we are still plenty of time. Let's go. Now. Something wrong with, okay. Now again, let's make other examples. Here again, we are in the domain of, sorry, I don't like this camera. I don't like to see myself. Sorry. okay. Let's continue with this idea. Okay, follow the medium, follow the user. Some also in some from some point of view, you will see. But let's try to focus a little bit on social media, okay, and social media metadata. Especially because, I repeat, we will do a lot of exercises on social media. So let's try to use this focus here. And also, let's start with this idea of vanity metrics of Richard Rogers, okay? Again, I put this reading in the slides. I also created a folder with all the slides of the summer school, so after I will show you. And so, the idea of Richard Rogers is the following. When we approach social media environment, we find and we can use a lot of metadata like hashtag, retweets, mentions, likes, and whatever, you name it, okay? They are super, super useful, especially from a methodological point of view. But first and foremost, you have to try to resist the temptation to just follow the logic of the platform itself, in which the platform use these devices. I mean, to put it simply, we must try to go beyond the brute count of stuff, okay? Just, I don't know, following brands and say, okay, Louis Vuitton has X number of followers and Gucci has this number of followers. I mean, it's not enough. This is interesting from a specific marketing point of view, from the point of view of the marketing of the platform. Also, for example, try to follow and understand which are the trending topic on Twitter today. Okay, it's nice, but it's nice from the marketing point of view of the platform itself. If you want to repurpose these metadata from our social research purpose, we have to look this metadata from a different point of view. And or sometimes we can try, I mean, to do that, sometimes also we can try to combine this metadata in new ways. So repeat, let's try to go beyond vanity metrics, meaning let's try to see all this metadata from a different point of view. And Richard Rogers gives many examples that I suggest you, for example, to follow in your, if it is the case, in your projects. For example, he says, when you follow political issues, #climate change, okay? I collect on Twitter all the hashtags, all the tweets containing the hashtag climate change, okay? So I have this big data set, I have a big public converging on this hashtag. And first thing first, I can try to see which are the dominant voices. Second, I can see what is the concern of this public. And third, I can check what is the commitment of this public around this hashtag climate change. So don't worry, let's see some example you will immediately understand. So when I follow this hashtag climate change and try to study the public, I can isolate different voices, okay? And it's pretty simple. I can see, for example, which are the users that tweet the most. So which are the most active and try to understand why. And at the same time, I mean, I always suggest to try a different strategy, especially if you are at the very beginning of your inquiry. I can see which are the users that are most retweeted. And so in some way, their voice is dominant, is more heard than other. I can try to see which are the users that they never quite, they just tweet one time, or they were never retweeted. So the very non-dominant voices, okay? So a first thing I can do when I explore a very, very big database is try to distinguish and isolate different voices in the data set or in the public and try to understand why I have these different voices and what they say. Then I can look at the concern, and it is something that you can do very, very easily using hashtags. And I give you a couple of examples. This one, this is very easy and beautiful. Notwithstanding, I mean, the visualization is ugly. What they did here, they follow some profile on Twitter related to actors related to health topic, like physician, doctors, journalists, and so on and so forth. And they check every time they mention HIV, okay? And then they saw the keywords and associated hashtag, and they discovered that in most of the case, in this public, the main concern that when they talk about HIV was business. So for example, they talk about vaccine HIV, which can be a good business and so on and so forth. Vice versa, topic specifically related to health were very, very minoritarian. In fact, I don't know if you can see the word health here at the bottom is very, very small, okay? So we can say that the concern of this public related to this topic of HIV is business, okay? Vice versa, we can also check the concern. So basically we can study hashtags or topics, whatever, over a certain period of time. Now, I give you here an example taken from a website, not Twitter, because it's easier to explain. But as you can imagine, it's even easier, I mean, to study this concern and commitment on Twitter because you have hashtags, okay? But let's make this example of commitment using this website of Greenpeace. So again, the digital network scholars, what they did, they took the website of Greenpeace and they monitored, they collected data for 7 years, okay? And each year they checked the campaigns promoted by Greenpeace. And they first discovered that that in these 7 years, they had a specific concern. And this concern was where this one, so nuclear, oceans, toxic forest, climate, peace, sustainable trade, genetic engineer, and agriculture. But, I mean, we had this concern for the 7 years, but we have a different commitment. Because as you can see, in all the 7 years, they keep touching this topic, nuclear, ocean, toxic, climate, peace and disarmament, but not, for example, agriculture. Agriculture appears only 3 times and not every year as nuclear or oceans. So did you get this point and the difference between concern and commitment? Make sense? Thank you. Thank you, guys. Another nice thing that you can do, and I'm sure that you can use this in your project, is to spot the program and the anti-program. So what is the meaning? Very, very easy. I mean, when we follow, let's say, social issue, political issue, on Twitter or Instagram, whatever, it's normal. I mean, it's very frequent that around this issue, they appear, it appears a public, okay, but also appears a counter public. And this what happened, for example, in 2015, when the US Supreme Court ruled about same-sex marriage. Sorry, there is someone using a drill. Can you hear me?
Yes.
Yeah.
Yes.
No. Si sente un po' il microfono. Non manca molto comunque. Scusa. Sorry, this is not, well, I mean, when you do lesson at home, this is the nice thing that happens. So that what's happened in 2015 when the US Supreme Court ruled in favor of same-sex marriage, okay? And in the very moment, in that very moment on Instagram, people started, I mean, posting photographs using this hashtag, celebrate pride. You can see on my left. But at the same time, a counter public emerged made of user using this hashtag, Jesus wins, which is actually the opposite. And so in this way, I mean, this is the case made by digital method scholars, okay? So they collected the post with hashtag celebrate pride and the hashtag with a post with the hashtag Jesus win, and they identified this program and anti-program, okay? Of course, program and anti-program is conventional. I mean, you can call Jesus win program and celebrate pride anti-program. It depends from your starting point and your point of view. But in this case, and of course, the program was celebrate pride. You isolate program and anti-program, you can start doing other nice things. For example, you can study the positioning of different actors. And as one can imagine, that time, for example, Hillary Clinton used a lot of the hashtag celebrate pride. So she positioned herself along this public, so celebrate pride. And as you can imagine, Donald Trump in that period used a lot of this hashtag Jesus wins, so positioning on the anti-program. And also you can see the alignment. So the alignment is basically the same thing of positioning, but is about the language, okay? So when you have program and anti-program, a public and counter-public, it's normal that these two entities use different languages, and you can spot these different languages doing a hashtag analysis or a more refined keyword analysis. In this case, I give you an example I did with my students last year about following the hashtag Immuni, Immuni was the smartphone application that was meant to be used to track the coronavirus, the spreading of coronavirus in Italy, but it failed for many ways. And basically for this hashtag, we found basically the program and anti-program, the public and counter-public, because we spotted different actors, but also different kind of languages. Mm? So because on one half, we had a cluster of hashtag, like this one on the top, with hashtag with like privacy, guarantee privacy, cybersecurity. So people basically very, very concerned with this Immuni app, because they believed that this app was a threat to the privacy and the liberty of people. Vice versa, we had the counter public. They use hashtags like that one below, like Torniamo Liberi, so let's be free again, social distancing, innovation. So a public that was minoritarian, as you can see here, that was made of people that were happy about this introduction of Immuni app, because in their opinion was a nice idea to limit, at least contrast, the spreading of coronavirus. Now, let's do with the very last part of this lesson, okay? Do you mind if I go straight without breaks, so maybe we can finish earlier, and then also because you have another lesson with Guido, so I don't want to overstuff you with concepts. But you will see, this is very, very practical. Okay, let's talk about research question, and especially how to formulate a proper research question when we do digital research, digital social research. Okay, what is a research? First and foremost, pardon me for this silly slide. I mean, this is something that I use with my student. I know that you know what is a research question, but just to having a start, okay? So a research question is an interrogative statement in which you make explicit what you want to know about your area of interest. Developing a research question is a method of narrowing down, focusing more directly on what it is that you want to know about, your topic of interest. So for example, as you can imagine, you can't say, I want to study influencers. Okay, I need to narrow down and focus my interest of research. So for example, I can elaborate much more specific questions. So how do influencers manage their fan base on Instagram? How do influencers negotiate their online and offline identity? Okay, so it's mandatory to narrow down your interest of research using a proper research question. First, before elaborating your research question, you must decide in which field you want to play, okay? So you want to do a descriptive research or an exploratory research, because of course, the research question can change a lot according to these different fields. I say in this summer school, mostly we will see this descriptive approach, which is more qualitative and is more aligned with our idea of digital methods. I mean, at least the idea we have in Italy at Milano. So for example, a very, very nice, very interesting descriptive research question can be how many selfies are on Instagram, okay? Can you guess how many selfies are on Instagram? Say a percentage.
Twenty-five percent.
Cool. Any other idea?
20.
20?
65.
I mean, basically, we have a similar idea, huh? A lot of selfies. Just a curiosity, it's not related to this lesson. It's just taking the piece a little bit. I checked some data from Instagram, and it seems that I mean, we have 40 billions of photos on Instagram so far, but the number of selfies is 0.7%. Okay, so basically nothing. Probably is that we are when we go to Instagram because we follow influencers, of course, because they are cool and they use a lot of selfies, but it seems that is a very, very minoritarian topic on Instagram, the selfie. By the way, let's cut the bullshit, let's continue. Or a descriptive question can be, how are the selfies distributed across different cities all over the world? And if you check this project, Selfie City, you can find online, is a project of Lev Manovic. They tried to answer to this question. So they try to map this distribution of selfie all over the world. Or vice versa, we can go for an explanatory research and so a explanatory research question that usually needs knowledge of statistical techniques. And you can ask yourself, for example, can user activities or sentiment on Twitter be useful to predict elections outcome? And basically, a colleague of us, Andrea Ceron, from University of Milano, he wrote an article on this and he demonstrated that using Twitter, mixing the number of tweets and the sentiment, you can in some way predict the outcomes of election. And he was able to predict the outcome of the election in 2012 in USA. Let's skip this. Okay, a research question has to be narrow, and especially, I know that you know that, but this is a very important point we will see later. A good research question must entail concept that you can translate empirically, okay? It's very, very important that we put in our research question concept that we are sure that we can translate empirically. And of course, we should try to do something interesting with our research question. And of course, I go very, very, very quick here. I made some example for my students. This is not exactly for you, but gives you an idea why the first question is a very, very bad research question and why the questions below are much more better because are more specific and especially are full of concepts that I can observe. I can translate empirically. Now, all these rules, they of course apply in digital research, in research question when we want to do digital research. But we have to add some other specificity when we move in a digital field. First and first, we have to consider this. That when we do digital research, our unit of analysis usually, I mean, it's not necessarily always the case, but usually, especially in the stuff we will do in the summer school and the stuff I do with my colleagues, the unit of analysis is more the communication rather than the individual, okay? So what we have to study is this process of communication, how communication is structured by a digital environment, how different publics manipulate communication in some way, what kind of social formation emerge around a specific device like an hashtag, a branded hashtag, and so on and so forth. If you pay attention, I mean, if you go through the digital methods literature, you will find all studies like this. I mean, for example, when you fake news is the classical topic that you can study, and it's better to study with digital methods because with digital methods you can track the diffusion of fake news. Or using digital methods, you can study echo chambers. You can study algorithmic culture. So you see all communication phenomena rather than phenomena that are related to specific individuals. Because, I mean, I repeat, sometimes we can use the digital to study specific individuals, but for example, when we collect a big database, focusing on individuals and individual variable can be a slippery slope. Can be a little bit tricky. You can imagine why it's not always possible to follow individuals, understand who are the individuals, what they do on social media.
Yeah, because sometimes the real identity of a person isn't the same online.
Yes, could be in some way. Thank you. Not bad.
You just don't have the right information, basically. So, like when you do a survey or even qualitative methods, I mean, like an interview, you ask people about demographic information. While if you're just scraping data from the internet, you basically don't know nothing about the people. You can know something, but I mean, you really don't know all the information that you can get with a survey.
Exactly. So thank you, Paola and Riccardo. This is basically the point. And I would add, if I may, that the very concept of individual, okay, tend to blur when we are online. Because consider, for example, a Twitter account. A Twitter account can be used by many people at the same time. Or the same person can use many, many Twitter accounts. Or a Twitter account can be used by bots. Or I don't know if you know Lil Miquela or Instagrammers like Lil Miquela. Lil Miquela is an artificial intelligence. So again, this idea of individuals tend to blur when we do analysis on the digital. So it's better to focus on communication and cultural process. I mean, and we can do this very, very, in a very, very effective way. Sometimes better than with traditional methods. And as Riccardo said, also the classical demographical variables are not super easy to grasp on the internet when you scrape data from the internet, like age, sex, income, stuff like that. Vice versa, the digital is a good place for studying the so-called post-demographic variables, such as the taste, the culture, reputation, emotion, all this kind of stuff that in qualitative research were considered rightly so ephemeral, okay? So you can study emotion and taste using interviews, but they remain ephemeral. Vice versa, on the internet, the culture, the taste, the emotion, these usually ephemeral things, they become very, very material, and we can follow and measure them. So for example, a nice research question can be how the topics related to the hashtag MeToo on Twitter evolve over time. Okay, so maybe this question is not particularly interesting, but this was just an example of what you should ask to the digital domain when you enter digital domain. Vice versa, if you ask something like this, can be very tricky. So which are the difference of income between people using the hashtag MeToo on Instagram? Probably on Instagram, you can do a study on, again, culture, taste, conspicuous consumption, and see if people display his richness, for example. But knowing the income, you know, the age, this very specific demographic variable is not so possible, it's not reliable. And if you are interested, which are very, very important variable, please just use other methods, okay, and not digital methods. I give you an example. It's just a nice example just to share with you of the post-demographic variables and what you can do. Again, this is not this is something we do, me and Guido did for a client, Uber. So we didn't publish this thing because, I mean, it's not super accurate from a point of view, but it gives you an idea of what are the post-demographic variables. And now you can use post-demographic variable to answer to a specific question. So in this case, our client, Uber, wanted to know the political orientation of their followers on Twitter, okay? And of course, we couldn't ask each follower the political orientation. We couldn't, submit a survey, okay? So what we did, we scrape all the followers of Uber, and for each follower, we scrape the followers of the follower, okay? And so we check if these people followed some newspapers. And you know, in Italy, the newspapers are very, very politically connotated. So in this way, we guessed at least the political orientation of the follower of Uber. And you can see many of them follow newspaper like Repubblica or Unità, that are newspaper normally associated to the left or the center left. And the client was very, very happy because, I mean, he said, I mean, first at that time, Uber wanted to do a lot of lobbying in Italy. So that's why he wanted to know this political orientation. And also they were happy because, I mean, they said, okay, nice. This is a nice insight because we know that in USA is exactly the opposite. So the follower of Uber in general, client of Uber, tend to position themselves on the right wing. But let's close this parenthesis. Let's go specific on research question, and I give you just example, okay? That you can calmly read again and again at home. Also, we have just to let you know, we will make available this registration, the recording, sorry, of the lesson. I don't know exactly why, so be patient, but they will be out, no worries. So for example, what you can do when you explore digital environment, you can decide starting from a data-driven research question. So the data-driven research question is usually a research question that is inspired by the platform itself, is inspired by the way in which the platform structure its data, and so on and so forth. I give you some example. Look at this. This is a very, very famous data-driven research question elaborated in 2010 by Kvak and colleagues. And Kvak asked himself, is Twitter a social network or a news media? Okay, so he collected in 2009, so all the tweets of Twitter. So at that time it was possible because Twitter was small. And so he discovered that according to his data, Twitter was a news media, okay, rather than a social network, because the vast majority of posts, 80% of posts collected, all contained links, and most of them contained the links pointing to newspapers or news blog and so on and so forth. And vice versa, they discovered very, very little in terms of interaction, so people discussing among each other, mentioning each other. So he came to the conclusion that Twitter is more a news media than a social network. And if you look at Twitter now, it was right in my point of view. Data-driven research question is this one from Bernard Rieder and colleagues. So how do YouTube's algorithm organize videos on the homepage of YouTube? So you see a data-driven question that allows you to study how the communication is structured in a specific platform. Or you can start a theory-driven research question. So you can start from a very specific theoretical question that you have in mind, and you use digital data and digital methods to try to answer this research question. And this is what we did with Guido and Valentina, who is not here, about the infodemic. Last year, we asked ourselves this question. So regarding the circulation of fake news on Twitter during the COVID-19 in Italy, is it possible to talk about infodemic? Probably you remember, but last year people talked a lot about infodemic, okay? So in this very moment of pandemic, some commentators noted also an epidemic of misinformation that they called infodemic. So I read you the definition. Infodemic is an epidemic of misinformation spreading rapidly through social media platforms and other outlets that poses a serious problem for public health. Okay, so what we did, so we collected all the tweets related to coronavirus, okay, virus, so 10 million tweets, more, 7 million of tweets, and we check in this huge database the number of fake news, and we were able to answer our research question. So the answer is no. So we don't have, at least on Twitter in Italy, we didn't have an infodemia. We didn't have a problem of infodemia because over 7 million tweets, only 1.44% were fake news. And most of these fake news were just racist content, okay? So they were content that were used strategically to put forth some right-wing political agenda, but they were not a real threat to the public health, okay? I mean, if I post a tweet in which I say, okay, spicy food is a threat, spicy food can be used to cure COVID-19, I mean, this is a threat, okay, to public health. But vice versa, just posting racist content like, migrants bring coronavirus, and it's not a threat to public health. And so you see how you can use data-driven research question. Or last but not least, you can mix it, okay? So in my opinion, a very, very nice strategy is try to mix in a iterative way, in a dialogical way, data-driven and theory-driven research question. And this is what we did with Adam Armisen and Massimo when we studied One Direction on Twitter. So how research started? The research started from this research question. So we noticed that every day, for 1 week basically, every day in the trending topics, we always found hashtag related to One Direction. So One Direction, one big announcement, and so on and so forth. So we posed ourselves a data-driven research question. So we asked ourselves how it's possible, which is the logic behind this fact. So how it's possible that every day we have One Direction on the hashtag on the trending topic. So we collected all these tweets, and we discovered why. We discovered that this fan of One Direction, they basically spend the whole day copy and paste me hundreds of times the same hashtag on the tweets in order, without any kind of real conversation or whatever. They just copy and paste, they coordinate themselves, and they copy and paste this kind of hashtag in their tweets in order to push, okay, this hashtag on the trending topics. So that's why, that's the answer to the research question. But studying this kind of tweets, we also discovered that they, at the same time, play this game of visibility. They try to use to exploit this hashtag, One Direction, to get visibility from themselves. And so from the insight, we were able to elaborate a second research question. It is a more that theory, because it's about which kind of self-branding strategies do One Direction fans on Twitter use. So you see how you can combine, using a grounded iterative approach, different kind of research questions. Another trick I suggest you, when you approach digital media or social media, try to ask yourself, what I want to study? I want to study the society or the technology? I want to study the social phenomena or technological communication phenomena? And for example, this is a question that is important that we pose ourselves when we must deal with bots. And especially the groups that we will work on Twitter, they will find a lot of bots in the dataset. So what are you gonna do with bots? It depends, okay? Look, in the research I did with Guido on brand relation on Instagram, we found a lot of posts posted by bots using specific branded hashtag, and we discarded. So we throw in the bin this post, because we were specifically interested in studying what people did, I mean, ordinary users did with branded hashtag. Vice versa, if you are interested in fake news, if you are interested in politics, in extremist right-wing politics like Salvini in Italy, in this case, you should not discard the bots, okay? Bots are part of the communication ecosystem of these people, of this phenomenon, okay? And last but not least, also, let's consider this idea of operationalization, which is, I mean, the classical idea in social sciences, but I mean, try to adapt this idea in the digital environment. So be sure that you elaborate a research question with concept that you can follow, measure online. Okay, I give you some very, very basic examples. So if I want to study Brexit and I go on Pinterest, probably it's not a good idea. Why? And what I can do instead?
Because Pinterest is mainly related with images. So maybe Brexit is not the perfect topic to be studied on Pinterest, while, for example, using Twitter, which is, as we told before, a more news media rather than a social network, could be more useful.
Exactly, exactly that, Alicia. Okay, so Pinterest is not about political stuff. So maybe Twitter is a better choice. And again, if I want to study Euroscepticism on Twitter, should I follow the hashtag Europe? What do you think, guys?
Probably not. I think that will be more for positive views on Europe, and there should be an hashtag that is more appropriated for Eurosceptics, I think.
For example, whatever.
Yeah.
Probably I would go on some profiles or of Eurosceptics personalities, like political leaders in different countries, such as, you know, in Italy, in the Netherlands, and so forth. And then I will try actually to use those hashtags. Yeah. It could be an idea.
It's a perfect idea. Thank you, all of you. You nailed it, basically. I mean, that was the perfect answer. For example, I used another hashtag, spread, for example, but it was just my opinion, okay? So thank you, because we were exactly on the same page. And last but not least, this is the very last slide, and then you are free. Pay attention to the affordances, okay? So every social media is affordances. Affordances are the technical structure, okay, that shape the communication, but also pay attention, affordances is not only technical, it's the combination between technical structures and how these technical structures are used by participatory cultures, communities, crowds situated on a social media, okay? That's why you see we stress always this thing of follow the medium and follow the actors. Because when we do digital methods, it's very, very important to take in consideration affordances, but affordances emerge exactly from this combination, okay? From technical structure of a platform and a social norm that users using this platform build on top of those technicalities, okay? And so please, before entering whatever social media, try to study the functioning of the social media, try to understand the affordances of social media. In this way, it will be easier to make sense of what you will find on the social media. I give you a classical example. If I go on Facebook and I study a branded page on Facebook, like Nike or Jack Daniels, whatever, I see that I don't have a lot of interaction. Usually, make a check, go on Facebook and see branded pages. You will see that people, consumers, do not interact that much on that branded Facebook pages. But this does not mean that people are not interested in brand, okay? This is the functioning of Facebook. This is how people use branded Facebook pages, simply as a place to get information about the brand they like, but not as a place to create communities. For example, if you want to study a brand community, it's easier to follow some hashtag on Twitter or mainly forums. I mean, for example, in Italy, forums about motherhood are still a big thing, and they are the perfect place if you want to study a brand and online community, but probably not a Facebook page, exactly because of affordances, okay? Sorry, I forgot to give you the article of Elmond and Booker on affordances, which is super, super clear. So please, if you are interested, drop me an email that I will send you this article. And these are the recommended readings. You can find everything basically for free on Google Scholar. So go for it if you are interested to know more and go deeper all the points we touched during our lesson. So thank you so much for your attention. And I mean, we can close here, of course, but if you have questions, I'm here for you.
Thank you.
It's okay. So
one question. I actually wrote it into the chat. I had a question regarding the DMI tools and if we can use it for the research outside academia, because you showed some examples of using it for certain clients. So I was wondering if there are currently some restrictions how to use those tools for some business research purposes.
Okay, this is a super nice and perfect question. There are not many restrictions, it depends. For example, they have a Twitter tool that you can't use unless you are a student Amsterdam or student of Amsterdam, okay?
Mm-hmm.
But for example, a trick would be if you have time, you can attend a summer school in Amsterdam. They do very, very cool summer school and usually they give you the access to all the tools. Other tools are up to you. If you want to use an issue crawler, that tool that we saw for the reconstruction of networks, I mean, you can use it. If you want to use for a marketing purpose, you can do it. Also, for example, for issue crawler, you must send a request for getting a password for using it. But, I mean, I tell you, Petra, since we collaborate a lot, for example, I have many access, so if you're in trouble, please drop me an email. I can send you my password.
Thank you. I was just wondering if there are some restrictions, for example, as for this new tool for Facebook and Instagram, this CrowdTangle, can basically use it for academics only or academic research.
CrowdTangle is not a digital methods tool. It's something that you can make a request for. And you can use exclusively for academic purposes.
Yeah, so I was wondering if there is something similar for the DMIs as well.
No, they had, NetFeeds and also a tool for scraping Instagram, but Facebook shut down this tool because Facebook deemed it in some way illegal. Again, if you're interested in CrowdTangle, you can make a request or you can write me. I have CrowdTangle since you are in my research cluster. Sorry, guys, Petra is a privileged one. and you want to get data from CrowdTangle, I'm happy to add you CrowdTangle. You can use it, but only for academic purposes. So
please
don't do marketing stuff.
No worries.
But I mean, I'm not telling you, I'm telling to everyone. And I mean, also it's not super difficult to have access to CrowdTangle. So I don't know if Guido later will show you CrowdTangle. If not, drop me an email. I will share with you the link of CrowdTangle. It's not, I mean, if you're academic, a PhD, especially a PhD or postdoc or a lecturer as me, it's not so difficult to have access to CrowdTangle. But I repeat, if you're in trouble, Petra, I can share mine, okay?
Yeah, but sorry to drop in like that.
Hi.
So I will show you a little bit of CrowdTangle and I show you a little bit of a couple of DMI tools and a couple of scrapers, maybe, depends. So we will touch on that subject.
Okay.
No need to worry.
Perfect. Thank you.
Should we take a break so we are more fresh for the lesson of Guido at 12, at 11?
No problem for me.
So let's reconvene at 11, okay?
Yep.
I stopped the registration.
Okay.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thanks.